Professor Chopra, Chancellor UPS, Professor Suresh Kumar, Dean SOE, Professor Vijay, HOD for Chemical Engineering, and my very dear friend, my mentor, Professor Gupta ji. Thank you for inviting me here today. It's a real honor for me to give this 7th annual distinguished lecture in Chemical Engineering at the UPS, following the long list of illustrious people who have given this lecture before me. It's a little intimidating to stand here and talk to you. Thank you also, Professor Vijay, for that very long and really uncalled for introduction. Those awards don't really mean a lot. I think what is important for me is the work that I do, and more importantly, the impact that it will hopefully make. That is more important than any other award that any man may want to give me. So I have chosen to talk today on this topic, which has been very close to my heart for the last 10 years or so. My entry into this area began at NCL 10 years ago, when we decided to enter this relatively new field, and I will tell you a little bit more about it. But I think it's a very relevant topic for future, and I thought it was probably the best topic that I could talk about at the UPES, given the focus of this university's on energy and fuels and so on. Okay, so without further ado, I would like to directly get into my talk. I've been given 1.5 hours, which is a very generous time for my talk. I don't think I can speak for 1.5 hours, so I welcome all of you to, you know, let this be a more interactive session. If you have any question at any point of time, feel free to raise your hands and I'll try my best to answer them. Okay, so the title of the talk, as you can see, is Hydrogen Ecosystem, and importantly, the various challenges and opportunities in this new ecosystem that I will touch upon during the course of this lecture. Before I begin though, I must tell you a little bit about where I come from. So this is the Reliance Corporate Park in Navi Mumbai. It's some 300 odd acres of land, lush green. It stands on a land where there earlier used to be a plant owned by the Mafatlal group. It was called Nosil. Those who have stayed in Mumbai, Nosil was a landmark petrochemical plant in the area. But when, as the world globalized and the scale of manufacturing of everything increased many folds, Nosil was no longer at the right scale of manufacturing. Therefore, it wasn't profitable. It was shut down by Mafatlal Group. Reliance bought it out, and the first thing they did was to raise down the plant. The reason being that the pilot plant of Reliance at Hazira was bigger than the manufacturing plant of Nosil. So Nosil didn't even make sense as a pilot scale plant. So the whole area was then converted into a corporate park, and we have all the business functions at the corporate park. One of them, of course, is the Reliance R&D. What you see here is not the R&D building. It's one of those many geo buildings that have mushroomed on campus. But it's a campus that has close to 70,000 odd people, most of them coming from geo. But about 20,000 from other business activities. In the R&D, of course, there is almost 450 to 500 staff. And when I say staff, it means both the scientists and the technicians. The R&D is sort of distributed at multiple locations, 4 locations. This is the Reliance Corporate Park in Navi Mumbai is the nerve center. It has the largest number of staff in the R&D located at RCP. And then there is a smaller group at Hazira, Vadodara and Jamnagar. They essentially serve the local manufacturing sites and try and resolve issues at the local manufacturing level. So this is more of a firefighting R&D, but a little longer term R&D is what happens at the Reliance Corporate Park. Most of the staff that we have are PhDs with at least a couple of years of postdoc experience, if not more. Or some of them have PhDs and have worked in industry and have come back and joined us. These are roughly the areas where the research and development happens, and some of them you can see are very relevant to the immediate businesses of Reliance. For example, polyolefins, elastomers is a business that we have recently have formed a joint venture with a Russian company called Sibur. Refining, scale-up, catalysis, and so on. These are areas which are directly in line with the Reliance business. But as you can see, there are some areas which are may not seem relevant directly to the Reliance business, but we believe that we need to play in these areas because this is where the business might be eventually going. For instance, there's a huge amount of work happening today in what is called the Industry 4.0 paradigm, right, which is bringing in artificial intelligence, data analytics, machine learning kind of tools to help optimize refining processes, right? So think of, so if you go to our Jamnagar plant, for example, I think I've heard that many students have gone on industrial visits to Jamnagar plant. And those of you who have been there will probably see the control center at Jamnagar, right? Has anybody seen the control center at Jamnagar in J3 or J4? No? So it looks like NASA's space center, control center, right? It looks like that. I mean, it's a room maybe three times bigger than this hall, and just full of humongous screens, okay? Just all around the place, humongous screens, and those screens are displaying data coming from plant real time. Okay, so this you know, millions and millions and millions of gigabytes of data that is pouring in, you know, per second into that control center. Okay, now conventionally you would just sit there and look at the parameters, and you know, through experience you try and control the plant, and you don't have to do anything; it's all automatically controlled anyway. But today what the refining industry is doing is actually taking that data, subjecting it to you know, the latest data analytics techniques, and actually predicting what is going to happen in the next second or in the next half an hour or in the next day and so on. So a lot of artificial intelligence and machine learning is now coming in the refining industry from a purely data mining process control you know, side of it, and there's a lot of work now happening in Reliance R&D to sort of kickstart that process. Another example is that of biology. Now you might say, what will a petrochemical company have any interest in biology, right? We have a huge program on what we call algae to oil, okay? And we believe that in the future, as and when the fossil fuel resources start depleting, maybe there's an alternate way of creating oil. Why oil? Because, you know, we are all so used to oil. Now, I will actually in my talk tell you that maybe there are other energy sources that are better, but, you know, we are so used to oil, and if there is another way of making oil, maybe a more sustainable way of making oil, you know, why not, right? And so there's a huge team that has been working for the last 10 years on trying to, you know, understand right from genetic engineering to cellular biology to systems biology, okay, that is as the algal tissue, for example, and how all of that can be used to produce oil from, you know, photosynthesis, right? And then all the downstream, you know, classical chemical engineering, how do you take that algae which has lipids in it, remove the lipids from it and convert that into oil, right? So a huge program is currently going on at the Reliance R&D, which is focused on converting algae to oil. I come from the Advanced Materials and Alternate Energy group. That's a new group that I have created at the Reliance R&D. And what I'm going to talk about today is one area where I'm particularly interested in, focused on at the present, in the alternate energy domain. We have a phenomenal analytical laboratory where all kinds of analytical tools for materials, for petrochemical products, for upstream, downstream, all of those are present. It's a really state-of-art analytical laboratory, and also a very nice simulations group that looks at, of course, not just the CFD and reactor engineering modeling, but also down to more mesoscale kind of simulations. So quite an integrated simulations group as well. So that's the areas of interest at present in the Reliance R&D. Okay, so you know, company policy dictates that I start with a disclaimer, which basically just says that the views that I will be expressing in this lecture are my own and not necessarily that of my company, and that's just the policy statement that I have to show. Okay, so let's start with the motivation of why I am interested in this area of hydrogen ecosystem. Let's look at more, you know, at a global level, and then zoom into India, and then zoom into a few applications, and then discuss what this hydrogen ecosystem looks like. Okay, so if you look at the India energy scenario, so this is the world energy scenario. These are all the important countries in the world, and how much energy do they consume, right? And if you look at this list, we are the third largest consumer of energy in the world. Okay, per capita, we are much less than many of the other countries, just because our population base is very large. But also because our population base is very large, we become the third largest consumer of energy in the world. It amounts to about 900 million tons of oil equivalent, which amounts to about 1300 million tons of coal. That's how much energy we consume. Okay, so where does this energy come from, right? And I'm sure there are this kind of data for a university like UPS and a chemical engineering course there. You have probably seen this, so it's just a reiteration of some facts that you already know. So if you look at the 2016-17 data, where did this energy come from? About 75% or more of that energy actually came from some kind of fossil fuel. Whether it is coal, whether it is petroleum, whether it is natural gas, some kind of depletable, non-sustainable fossil fuel is the major source of our energy. And you can see how, you know, the renewables that we talk about, okay, is still a small fraction of the total energy that we consume as a nation. As I said, we are about 5 times lower in terms of per capita energy consumption in the world than Europe and the US as well. The problem, however, is that we are, you know, we also are in a very difficult geopolitical situation. We do not have resources of our own, which means we have to import all of this 75% of energy that we are using. We have to import all of it, or most of it, right? And because we are in a difficult geopolitical scenario, we have to sort of cut deals which are very, very complex, right? And you can see two dignitaries visiting in the recent years. They come from two very different political ideologies, right? And to be able to talk to both of them without disturbing the relation with the other is a trapeze artistry. You know, if you fail, you will fall down, right? And that's very, very difficult to do, right? This is just a table that shows the consumption of these fossil fuels, how much of that is actually imported, and what it means in terms of the cost to the exchequer. Right? So we pay billions of dollars a year just to import the energy that we use. And remember, this energy import is also not easy. It's not like you pay the dollars and you get the energy. You have to really play around the politics and also the geography, you know, getting a pipeline through the Himalayas or getting a pipeline from Pakistan, you know how difficult that is going to be, right? So it's not just a question of paying money to get the energy. It's a question of being able to balance that politics and maneuver around that difficult politics and the geography to be able to get that energy. So strategically, for the country, energy is extremely important to make sure that we sustain our 7 or 8% GDP growth. At the same time, to get that energy becomes a very, very big challenge. So the question that one needs to continuously ask ourselves is, are there alternative ways of energy which do not, you know, make us so dependent on these very tricky geopolitical situations. Now, electricity is a small part of that energy landscape, right? So let's look at the Indian electricity scenario. And this is 2018 data. We have, as of 2018, December 2018, about 350 gigawatts of installed electricity generation capacity in the country. Okay, and this government in particular, I must say, has done enormous efforts in making sure that the electricity coverage, you know, has almost reached 100%. What used to be about 75% in 2012 has now reached more or less 100% in the last 5 or 6 years, right? And so this is really, really creditable. Okay, it was not good enough to say that we have 600 million households that do not have electricity. You know, you don't feel proud to say when you go and stand in a podium and say that, you know, 600,000 households do not even have electricity, right? It doesn't make you feel proud. But with that kind of number, now you feel a lot more comfortable, right? Our per capita electricity use is actually far less than what it used to be earlier. Much of it is also because we live in a tropical country, thankfully, unlike some places in Dehradun and so on. Most of the country is near the tropics where you don't need a lot of heat for just surviving, right? Whereas if you go in the developed nations, a huge amount of electricity is actually used for just survival, you know, just heating homes is a huge bill of electricity. Many other sectors, consumption of electricity is all listed here, but the point is that, you know, we still consume much less electricity per capita than what many other developed countries use. And secondly, if you look at the distribution of the electricity, still a lot of it comes from fossil fuels, about 55% coming from coal and lignite and gas and so on. And this fraction here, which is the renewables, which includes hydro, nuclear, solar, wind and biomass, that is about 20%. So it's a little better than the overall energy scenario. The overall energy scenario was much lower, is about 10%. This one is about 20%. Right? Now, of this 20%, with the current impetus on solar and wind, just the solar and wind has now reached about 10%. In fact, in January this year, we first time reached 10% of electricity scenario coming from solar and wind. So keep this number in your mind. Okay, so with all this energy coming from fossil fuels and the electricity coming from fossil fuels, the impact of that is obvious. All of you going to Delhi will realize this situation in coming November, December, Jan, Feb. The same situation exists in Mumbai, same situation exists in Bangalore. You have smog everywhere, right? Today's CO2 equivalent emissions, which is CO2 mainly, but also a little bit of other gases, which are greenhouse gases like methane and so on, that's about 2,000 million tons of CO2 equivalent. Okay, and that number has sort of stayed more or less constant from 2014 onwards. I just checked the latest numbers in January this year. This number is about 2,400 million tons of CO2. Okay, hasn't increased that much. However, if the same trend continues, by 2030, it is estimated that we will double the CO2 emission. So about 4,000 million tons of CO2 will be emitted at the current rate at which the GDP is growing and the current rate at which we are burning fossil fuels. A little bit more on the greenhouse gas emissions, and this is data coming from the World Bank. There are two data that I'm showing here. This is total emissions of CO2, and this is kilograms of CO2 emitted per purchasing power parity, okay, of the GDP. Now this is the denominator, the PPP is the denominator, and that sort of helps to normalize the development index of the country, okay, with respect to how much CO2 is being emitted. So if you look at this number, for instance, all the oil-rich countries, right, whether it is Russia, the Middle East, some of the African nations, all the oil-rich countries actually emit a huge amount per purchasing power parity. Okay? India is probably in the number two list of nations in terms of emissions. But if you look at the total emissions of CO2, and they are important, they are very important, as I will touch upon in the next few slides, we emit about, as I said, 2.2 million tons of CO2. Okay, so again, I repeat the number that by 2030 we will reach about 4,000 million tons of CO2 emissions. Now, what does this all mean? Why are we so worried about CO2? So, there are five graphs of the IPCC report that came out in November last year, and they become really, really famous. Everybody talks about the five charts of IPCC report. Okay, so the first chart is the CO2 concentration in ppm in the atmosphere versus, of course, the Earth. This is the history of CO2 concentration. And this actual data recorded one at the South Pole and one at the tropics, which is a beautiful volcanic island in the Hawaii's. Okay, that's the Mauna Loa. So this is the data from both these monitoring stations, which clearly show an increase in the CO2. So this is undisputed. You know, some politicians may talk about whether really there is a climate change happening, whether the CO2 emissions are really happening or not, but this is real data, and real data is something you cannot deny. So this is CO2 emissions as has happened over the last 50 years or 60 years. If you look at the summer sea ice, okay, this is the ice at the poles, okay, in the Arctic. This is the spread of the ice cap of Arctic, and you will very clearly see that the ice cap is melting, right? What that means is that the average temperature of the globe is increasing, the ice caps are melting, and as a result, the sea levels on an average are going to increase. And these are predictions of the global mean sea level in terms of meters as a function of years. And there are two scenarios that IPCC has painted. One is an optimistic scenario, which is the blue line. That is, if you take very aggressive measures in order to curb the CO2 emissions, this is the scenario you will see. Okay? Which still means that the sea levels are going to increase, but not as dramatically and as dangerously as you know, one would expect if you do nothing. So this is the do nothing scenario, which is the most pessimistic scenario, and that tells you that the sea level can rise almost exponentially, and this is very dangerous. The 0.8 meter level is the danger level, and what it means is several islands that we know of, including our own Lakshadweep, for example, will be simply wiped out, right? They will submerge, and that means a huge amount of population will have to be accommodated elsewhere, right? And so that's the most pessimistic or the dangerous scenario. If you look at the change in the average precipitation, right, and we keep talking about how rainfall pattern has changed, you know, in my lifetime for sure, you know, rainfall pattern has changed, and many people here whose hair is graying a little bit will agree with me that the rainfall pattern has changed, and you can see that happening here. So this is the optimistic scenario and this is the pessimistic scenario, and if you look at, so that's the pessimistic scenario. If you look at that, the sharp contrast in the colors are basically telling you the amount of precipitation, the disparity in precipitation that the world is going to have to experience. So there's much more uniform levels of precipitation, and this is the dangerous levels of the disparity in precipitation. So this means, for example, you will have suddenly a big shower, a thunderstorm, a flood in Rajasthan, right? Or Mumbai will have no rains for 2 months in the monsoon, right? So these are this kind of scenario. And finally, the most important chart that the IPCC has come up with is the global warming chart, right? So this is the global average surface temperature change. And what this change means is the change with respect to the pre-industrialized levels. Okay? Before the Industrial Revolution picked up, what was the global average temperature, and how that temperature is now increasing. These are the two scenarios, the optimistic scenario and the pessimistic scenario. The optimistic scenario says that we will, if we take very aggressive measures to curb the greenhouse gas emissions, we will hit about 1.5 degrees increase in temperature over pre-industrialized levels. Okay? But if we don't take any such measures, if the status quo continues, which if the likes of President Trump has his way, will most likely happen, then we are looking at a temperature rise which is in excess of 3.5 degrees C. And that is extremely, extremely dangerous, right? We do not want to get to that point, because it will kickstart these kinds of sea level increases, a collapse in the Arctic ice cap, and this kind of scenario where the world pattern completely changes, right? And causes a huge amount of disruption. So this is, you know, the scenario of why CO2 emissions are important. And with this kind of situation, in 2014, 169 countries came together in what is now famously called the COP21 Paris Convention. And all those countries signed a declaration that they will take certain measures to reduce their greenhouse gas emissions or to reduce their carbon footprint. India is a signatory to this, and it is its declared commitments, the INDC, these are national commitments for reducing the emissions, are all highlighted here. And some of them are probably worth reading. So we are committed to reducing our emission intensity of our GDP by 33%. Okay? This intensity of GDP is what I talked about in the previous slide. This is the kgs of CO2 per ppp of the GDP. Okay? So we are committed to reducing this by 33 to 35%. It's a modest commitment. It's a commitment that we will be able to, you know, if we go along this path today, we will be able to meet this kind of commitment. Second, 40% of our electric power installed capacity by 2030 will come from purely renewables. Okay, and I will talk a little bit about that. We will create an additional carbon sink. India is probably one of the few countries where the green cover, the forest cover in the country is actually increasing. Okay? Amazon basin is the other one, where because thanks to the global warming, the CO2 emissions, the Amazon is actually thriving. Right? Where I come from in Navi Mumbai, we have a creek, okay, that is joined to the sea, and along the creek we have mangroves. Okay? And I grew up in Mumbai. I knew what the mangroves looked like in the mid-80s. I'm back in Mumbai now, and I can see the mangroves, and they are spectacularly growing, right? And you know, it's thanks to all the emissions of the CO2 and the pollutants that are going in the not the chemical pollutants, the human waste that goes in the creek, actually, you know, is helping the mangroves to grow. Now, good or bad, but we are committed to creating this additional green cover that will capture about 2.5 to 3 billion tons of CO2. This is in fact so crucial, and I'll touch upon this again in the lecture, that you know, we really do not have many options about CO2. What do we do with that CO2? We are emitting it, we can't stop it, and we have no real solution of what to do with it. Okay? This is one of the most challenging problems that, you know, you as chemical engineers, the next generation, and your next generation is going to face. And you are the guys who need to solve this problem. Okay? We are sorry, we have raised our hands, we can't do much about it. Okay? But this is the fact. Okay? There is really no economically viable solution as of today for what to do with that CO2. The only solution we can think of as of now is this: increase forest cover. Okay? But it's not going to be enough. Alright, so these are our nationally declared commitments for the COP21 Paris Convention. And if all the countries including us do this, we will hit about 2 degrees scenario, not the 1.5 degrees global warming scenario. We'll hit about 2 degrees scenario, which is, you know, not too bad. Okay, now the Niti Aayog has a beautiful website, and I encourage all of you to sort of go and have a look at it. It's out there on Google. go to Niti Aayog energy calculator, okay, and you will be actually able to, it's a calculator you all can use, you know, you can actually create scenarios, okay, and look at how the energy flows are going to happen, okay. So what I'm showing here is what is called the Sankey plot, which is on the left hand side the various sources of energy. This is where the energy is coming from. So this is coal, oil, gas, biomass, solar, wind, hydro, nuclear, everything. So these are the sources of energy. And on the right hand side, you have the consumption of energy, the different sectors of consumption. So whether it is cooking, whether it is transport, whether it is industry, agriculture, telecom, and so on and so forth. So these are consumers of energy. And what the Sankey plots tells you is which of the sources is linked to which of the consumers, okay? And you can actually go and build these scenarios, okay, on the calculator. It's a wonderful calculator. And what you can see here is the best possible estimate in 2042. So we are painting the future, 2042, and we're looking at what might be the best possible scenario, right? And you can see these are some of the renewables. This is coal, this is oil, this is oil imports, this is indigenous oil, this is gas imports, this is gas, indigenous gas, and so on. And you can still see that in the most optimistic scenario in the future, 2042, still a lot of energy is going to come from fossil fuels. The thickness of the band indicates how much energy is going to come, right? The thinner the band, the smaller is the energy. So in the most optimistic scenario, still a lot of energy is going to come from fossil fuels, and much less, relatively much less, but still in not insignificant amount is going to come from the renewables, okay, oil, I mean in solar, wind, and hydro, and so on. And that scenario in terms of pie charts is given here, the energy demand versus the energy supply in 2042. Still coal will dictate, oil will dictate, and so on, but renewables now, this is the energy, not the electricity, right? This is the energy scenario. The renewables are about 20%, and the electricity from renewables is 40%, which is our INDC, our national commitment, okay? So 40% of India's electricity will likely come from renewable resources. Now what does that mean? So by 2047, let us say, India is likely to produce 2000 terawatt hours of renewable electricity, mostly coming from solar and wind. Why? Because as of today, when I talked about 21% of electricity coming from renewables, a large part of it comes from hydro, okay? But every drop of water, unfortunately today and tomorrow, that is going to fall on the country is more or less pre-booked. Okay, there isn't an additional drop of water that is going to be available for generating electricity. Okay, therefore you can't expect hydroelectricity to contribute to 40%. That's doubling the amount of renewable electricity. Okay, that is not going to come from hydro. Okay, so where else will it come from? It has to be renewables. We have to go from 21% today to 40% in 2042 or 2047, and that jump cannot come from hydro, right? So therefore it has to come from solar and wind. Now the problem with all of these renewables is that they are seasonal or diurnal, right? So they are variable sources. Every single renewable source of energy is variable, right? That means you can produce energy, let's say with solar and wind, you can produce energy for about 8, 10 hours, if you're lucky 12 hours a day, if you're really lucky 12 hours a day, okay, with solar and wind combined. But maybe let's say 10 hours a day on an average. For the remaining 14 hours a day, what do? Right? And therefore, you need to actually install much larger capacities than what you really need, okay? And then collect all that energy, but you are not going to use all that energy in the time that you are generating it. So that energy needs to be stored, right? So with all renewables, the energy has to be stored. And if you go from 20% to 40% only through solar and wind, a huge amount of energy needs to be stored, okay, and which is what I tell you about 100 to 350 terawatt hours of electricity has to be stored. If you cannot store it, then it will undergo what is called curtailment, which means that you have a solar plant, a solar utility plant, that will just stop running. Okay, it will not be able to feed the electricity that it is generating into the grid. Okay, because the grid becomes unstable if you suddenly feed in a huge amount of electricity. The grid is just not able to balance itself. Okay, so it's a very nice dynamic modeling problem. Those of you interested in dynamic modeling, grid stability is a huge problem for today and tomorrow. But this is our estimate. 2047, 40% electricity coming from renewables, much of it coming from solar and wind, which will amount to about 100 to 350 terawatt hours of electricity required to be stored. Now, there are many options for storages, many options for storages, and you can read about what could be the most competing options for storage. But we believe, some of us who are passionate about hydrogen believe, that there is no better option than hydrogen to store that electricity, which means you take this 100 to 350 terawatt hours of electricity and convert those electrons into molecules of hydrogen. So you're storing electricity not in the form of electrons, but in the form of molecules, in the form of a chemical. So you're storing electricity in a form of chemical energy. And if this can be done, if the electricity can be stored in the form of hydrogen, it will meet about 10 to 15% of the road transport demand in 2047. Okay, so this is a very interesting option of a fact and an option. The fact being that you will have to produce a huge amount of electricity and store it. That's the fact. And the option is to store that energy in the form of hydrogen. So the question then is, why hydrogen? Right? Why should I believe in hydrogen? If you look at the various sources of energies, and interestingly, if you go from top to bottom, it is sort of following the human civilization, the progress in human civilization, or it sort of follows the growth in GDP, if you wish. Okay? It is a measure of how civilization progresses, at least in the modern times. So starting from wood, which our ancestors used, 16 megajoules per kg is the energy density. Now to fossil fuels, about 50 megajoules per kg. And then look at hydrogen. It stands apart, 120 megajoules per kg. So gravimetrically, it's one of the highest energy density molecules, highest energy density fuel. Of course, uranium beats everything, and that's why nuclear is so very important. And nuclear, by the way, is coming in a big way back. Despite all the problems that it has faced, there's some very, very innovative companies in which HNIs like Bill Gates have invested billions of dollars, is coming back in a big way. Very classical chemical engineering, okay? Process intensive nuclear reactors. That's a separate topic for a talk. But so I'm not going to talk about uranium, but look at hydrogen and before that. Hydrogen stands out in terms of being one of the highest energy density fuels. And that's one reason why hydrogen could be a very interesting option for storing energy. Now, there's a hydrogen council, which is set up by several companies and countries of eminence, like Shell, Toyota, Praxair, and so many other companies. And my own company is aiming to become a member of the Hydrogen Council. And what the Hydrogen Council has come out is with a comprehensive report on what hydrogen can do. Okay? And they have identified 7 roles for hydrogen in decarbonizing various sectors. These are the 7 roles, starting from large-scale, efficient renewable energy storage and integration, distributed energy generations, buffer, as I talked about, storage of energy, buffer for electricity, decarbonizing transport, decarbonizing industry use, and I will touch upon some of these. So there are seven major areas in which hydrogen can be used to decarbonize, that is to reduce the carbon intensity of emissions, right? I talked about only electricity, but there are others which I will touch upon. The important point about hydrogen is that it comes from multiple sources, okay? It's not just coming from fossil fuels, but there are many multiple sources, for instance, water, ammonia, biomass, fossil fuels, and there are all sources of hydrogen. Secondly, there are no supply chain logistic issues, and this is a very important point from a national level. Okay, if you look at, everybody talks about lithium-ion batteries, right? And you would ask, if you are producing so much extra renewable energy, why not store it in lithium-ion batteries? And today that is being done, right? If you look at Elon Musk's company, they have put mega storage devices in Australia to store a lot of the excess solar power that is being generated. Is that a good option for India? That's the question, right? And the biggest problem with lithium-ion batteries is supply chain logistics. Lithium-ion batteries require lithium. Lithium-ion batteries require cobalt, two most important metals required without which lithium-ion battery does not work. We have zero resources for them, right? Where are the resources in the world? South American countries, Chile, Argentina, and some of the African countries like the Dominican Republic of Congo. All of these countries, if you look at, are politically very unstable. We have very poor relations with them in the sense of, you know, we have not gone ahead and bought mines. We don't own any lithium or cobalt mines in these countries. So what does this all mean? Strategically, today we import oil. We are dependent on oil-rich countries for our energy supplies. Tomorrow we will depend on some other countries for some other supplies. So strategically, you know, although the technology is out there, proven, the question is for India, does it make sense? Okay? And some of us believe that it doesn't really make sense for a huge scale lithium-ion battery technology to come into India because of this strategic supply chain issues. On the other hand, hydrogen has no such supply chain issues because it can be made from multiple primary sources. Okay? So this is the so-called hydrogen economy as suggested by the Hydrogen Council. And if one were to implement it in reality, these would be the outcomes of that hydrogen ecosystem. 18% of the final energy demand, that is one-fifth of the energy demand of the world, can be met by a green source, which is hydrogen. If you really use hydrogen to that scale, about 6 gigatons of CO2 abatement is possible every year. And that is right into the optimistic scenario of bringing the global temperature rise down to 1.5 degrees C. 2.5 trillion of annual sales for hydrogen are possible. So there's a huge new business opportunity that is possible. And about 30 million jobs, which is very important for a country like India, which will be created if one really adopts this scale of hydrogen economy. Okay, so what is this hydrogen economy I'm talking about? Remember, I said hydrogen is not a primary source of energy. Unfortunately, on planet Earth, hydrogen is not found as a gaseous element, right? It is always bound to something, either in a hydrocarbon or in water and or in ammonia and so on and so forth. So it's not a primary source of energy, right? And therefore, it is essentially an energy storage option, right? It's not a primary source, it's an energy storage option. But of course, once you have it, once you have isolated it, it can be used for power generation. So this whole concept of hydrogen economy, interestingly, was proposed way back in the 1920s by a scientist philosopher called Haldane, J.B.S. Haldane, who happened to have strong Indian roots. He actually spent a large part of his career at the Indian Statistical Institute in Kolkata. Okay? And it is in Kolkata that he proposed for the first time the concept of a hydrogen economy. Okay? It was then later formally coined and proposed in the General Motors Technical Center talk by a scientist at GM called John Bockrix. And since then, the hydrogen economy has been talked about a lot across the world. Now, you know, if you have an incumbent technology, for example, oil is an incumbent technology, right? It's there, it's been around for 100 years or more, and now you want to replace that with a new technology. You want to displace an incumbent technology with a new technology. What happens typically? You look at it historically for any technology. You have a technology that is well rooted and you want to displace it with a new technology. Okay, what happens? You create a hype. You create a hype around the new technology. Everybody starts talking about this new technology. Right? Everybody gets interested. Government puts in money. Industry puts in money. There's a huge hype. Okay, and then suddenly things crash because reality you know, hits you. Right? But then the technology matures. Okay, it's not right to have a big hype around it, but it's also not right to simply dump that technology. Because every technology has a place for itself. There's a placeholder for that technology. And the same thing has happened with hydrogen. In the early 2000s, for example, the late 90s and early 2000s, there's a lot of articles such as this. You know, you could find in journals and in blogs and so on. It's called the hype about hydrogen. People talking about, you know, hey, this hydrogen doesn't make sense. It's not economically viable and so on and so forth. So there's a big push. I remember in the Obama administration, in the Bush administration, before Obama administration, there was a huge push on hydrogen economy. Billions of dollars were given by the government for creating hydrogen technologies, right? And then the next administration came in and sort of wiped out all that hype, right? And today, it's nice because hydrogen has gone through that cycle and has reached a level of maturity where people are talking about real sense of where hydrogen will actually come in. And I must tell you that many of us feel that that lithium ion, for example, is actually going through that hype. There's a lot of hype created about lithium ion, and we believe that in the near future, you know, it will suffer a crash and then it will stabilize at some maturity level, okay, and find its right place in the energy mix of tomorrow. So hydrogen has already matured, and I'll show you some examples of that. So here are some recent international large-scale experiments on hydrogen. Okay, so this is no longer hype. This is no longer crazy ideas. These are large projects that are being run today at demo scales in many places in the world. There's a project called H2M, or the Magnum project in the Netherlands. And what it takes, what it talks about is taking natural gas coming from the North Sea, from Norway, bringing it to a huge mega scale reformer, such as the one you might see in Jamnagar, for example, convert that natural gas into hydrogen, and of course, you will release the carbon, right? You will release carbon in the form of CO2. Take that CO2, load it in ships, okay, and send it back to Norway for enhanced oil recovery. Okay? So you are taking that carbon, you're not emitting it, you're taking that carbon and pumping it down again and producing more gas from it. Okay? And today, these projects are actually showing the way. They're telling you that this is actually possible, not just technologically, but economically it is also possible. Okay? That's the whole idea of these projects. Right? Somebody has to do these large-scale demos and demonstrate to the world that this is possible. Right? And this is one of them. So the hydrogen comes in here and then it does multiple things. Part of it goes for transportation, for building heating and so on. Much of it is converted into electricity and then is fed into the grid. Okay? So once you have hydrogen, you have multiple uses for it. You can use it for simple hydrogenation chemistries, refining uses a lot of hydrogen, steel plants use a lot of hydrogen. As purely a molecule for hydrogenation or for reduction. You can use hydrogen as a fuel for transportation. You can use hydrogen to convert back into electricity and feed into the grid. So hydrogen, therefore, is very, very versatile in that context. The second project, and a very similar project, is happening in the north of England called the H21 project. And again here, the idea is to really decarbonize the residential heating, which actually consumes a lot of electricity for heating. People are trying to switch from natural gas-based building heating to hydrogen. This is really large scale, about 12% of the UK population is targeted for residential heating, switching from natural gas to hydrogen. The idea is the same. You take natural gas, reform it to make hydrogen, trap the CO2 back in the fields for enhanced oil recovery, and that would cause about 12.5 million tons of reduction of CO2 per year, right, with this kind of program. The third program is happening in Sweden. It's called the hybrid program, and it actually is targeting one of the most difficult industrial sectors, which is iron and steel. Okay? The conventional iron and steel plant has a coker plant and a blast furnace, which basically takes the iron ore and reduces it to iron, pig iron, right? And that is done today by carbon. Right? Where is that carbon coming from? It's coming from coal. Most of it is coming from coal. And so all of that CO2 is getting emitted, right? And that's about 1600 kilograms of CO2 per ton of steel that you and iron that you produce. So that's the amount of CO2. And these technologies have been around for, you know, donkey's years, right? And people just don't want to change them, right? And so this is one of the biggest polluters in terms of greenhouse gas emissions, right? And what is the hybrid going to do? It's going to take hydrogen. So it's a direct reduction process, not through carbon, but iron ore reduced directly to iron through hydrogen. Right? As a result, the only emission is that of moisture, water vapor, and a little bit of CO2 that gets emitted through subsidiary processes. So 1600 kg per ton of iron reduces to 25 kg of CO2 per ton of iron.
Sir, how does this matter? Doing the reduction by using hydrogen or by using carbon monoxide, when the hydrogen is produced from steam reforming.
Right. So here the hydrogen is not coming from steam reforming. The hydrogen is.
The earlier one, what you have mentioned, the Magnum project in Netherlands.
Yeah.
Again, it is produced from steam reforming, and you said the carbon dioxide generated is taken back for back pressure.
That's right.
So that's why.
So the CO2 goes back in the sediment.
I want to have one more question. Can that carbon dioxide being used for
dairy farming? Yes, so those technologies are definitely, you know, being researched today. There is no commercially viable dry farming technology as of now practiced. Okay, there are demo projects, but not at the practicing level. Right? So CO2, as I said, there isn't really a good option today available, which is economically viable at the scale that we are talking about. But yes, dry farming is one option. There are other, you know, if you believe there's somebody here working on CO2 to methanol, right? This is the Olaf technology, right? So the Olaf catalysis to convert CO2 to methanol. So the science is known, the techno-commercial viability needs to be demonstrated, right? So today the best option for CO2 is to push it down into the sediment and use it for enhanced oil recovery. The CO2 gets captured back in the sediments. So it's not released. That's the best option as of now. The other technologies will eventually come up, and they better come up. Okay, so these are three projects that I talked about. And I often say that, I was talking to some of the faculty yesterday and today also, that for India, we wake up about a new technology when our neighbor, you know, goes far ahead. So we woke up to lithium-ion batteries when China was way ahead in lithium-ion batteries, right? The largest producer of lithium-ion batteries in the world today. We woke up to solar when China had completely captured the solar market. We are waking up to methanol economy when the world's largest producer of methanol is China, right? So, you know, let's look at China. Let's be realistic. If that's how India works, then let's look at China. So here is what China is doing in hydrogen, right? They are targeting the Beijing Winter Olympics 2022, okay? Just like Japan is doing, targeting the Summer Olympics that's coming up next year, you will see hydrogen economy on display in Japan, okay, in the Summer Olympics next year. Similarly, you will see hydrogen economy in China on display in the Winter Olympics of 2022. So what are they doing? They're setting up almost 100 megawatts of wind turbine and about 22 megawatts of solar. This electricity is then fed into huge electrolyzers, which will produce hydrogen, about 1000 nm cube per hour of hydrogen production through water electrolysis, and then it will basically go into transportation. So all the vehicles that will transport people and whatever else in the Beijing 2022 Olympics, every single vehicle will run on hydrogen. So this, not just this, they have taken 153 square kilometers of area which contains two small hills. They have flattened the hills. They have moved 7 villages out of that place, okay? And they have set up a hydrogen ecosystem in 154 square kilometers. Every single fuel cell manufacturer, hydrogen manufacturer, electrolyzer manufacturer in the world has now set up offices in China in this 154 square kilometers area. They run from motorbikes to trams in that 154 square kilometers purely on hydrogen. Okay? So if China is doing this, hopefully our country will wake up at some point of time and look and start thinking about it. These are commercially available vehicles today that run based on hydrogen. Not by burning hydrogen, there is no combustion here, but hydrogen is converted into electricity through fuel cells, and I'll talk about that. So this is Toyota's Mirai, this is Honda's Clarity, and this is Hyundai's Tuscon. Three passenger cars in the luxury segment, which are called fuel cell electric vehicles, FCEVs. This is the French company called Alstom Engineering, which is the largest producers of metro carriages. In fact, some of our Mumbai metro carriages come from Alstom. This is the tram that runs on hydrogen. This is Toyota's truck, semi-truck, or they call it semi-trailer, that's purely running on hydrogen. So these vehicles today are commercially available. The point I'm trying to make is there are these large demo projects today running in various countries around the world, and commercial products that have come out that tell you that hydrogen is sort of slowly becoming a more mature technology. And now let's look at the hydrogen scenario in India. We have, I think, two roadmaps that the ministry came up with, the latest being in 2006, with the hydrogen roadmap that was written by the, commissioned by the MNRE. And it had very nice targets. You know, it looked at 1 million vehicles based on hydrogen energy, 1,000 megawatts of power generated based on hydrogen energy by 2020. That's next year. And nothing really has happened on the ground. Okay? So I really think we should look at China and start doing something more seriously. Okay, so let's look, jokes apart, let's look at, you know, why is it that hydrogen is a slow beginner, and why is it that it takes a little while for the hydrogen economy to actually sink in. This is what I call the hydrogen value chain. Okay? On the left hand side are technologies that produce hydrogen, right? Because we know that hydrogen is not available on planet Earth as a free gas. It has to be extracted from other primary sources. So these are technologies, and there are only listed two, but there are many technologies. So this is your classical steam methane reformer, SMR, and this is your classical water electrolyzer, right? This uses natural gas, reforms it with steam to produce hydrogen and CO2, and this splits water by electrolysis using electricity. So two technologies and more which are producers of hydrogen. These are technologies for storing and transporting hydrogen. There's a faculty member here who's looking at transporting hydrogen through pipelines. May not be as pure hydrogen, but maybe mixed with natural gas, but being transported through pipelines. Today you have technologies that can store hydrogen up to 900 bar pressure in large cylinders like these and transported across countries. You also have ships that liquefy hydrogen and are transported across continents. In fact, Japan is looking at ship-based transport of hydrogen from Australia and Brunei. You have technologies that capture hydrogen in the form of a liquid. Okay, so this is called an LOHC, a liquid organic hydrogen carrier. Okay, it's nothing but a cyclic aliphatic compound from which you can dehydrogenate and remove hydrogen, convert that into an aromatic compound, and that aromatic compound can be brought back somewhere and rehydrogenated. Okay, so the hydrogenation and dehydrogenation cycles can be used to store hydrogen and remove hydrogen. And then of course ammonia, which has the largest amount of hydrogen per weight than any other compound. So these are technologies for storing and transporting hydrogen. And finally, at the end of the value chain, you have technologies for using that hydrogen. So here is a technology for converting hydrogen into electricity, these two. So this is a power backup system, I'll talk more about it. This is a solid oxide fuel cell data center fuel cell for converting hydrogen into electricity. And of course I talked about transportation sector. So this is the value chain, and there are challenges in every aspect of this value chain, and the reason for that are the following. So today hydrogen is priced as energy and not as a molecule. And I'll tell you an example. If you go to a chloralkali plant, right, such as let's say an Aditya Birla plant or even Reliance chloralkali plant, okay, we produce caustic, right, and we produce tons of hydrogen as a byproduct. It's free, okay. But of course, if you ask Reliance, you know, what will you do with that hydrogen? Let's say we'll burn it in some process. So it's used as energy. If you want to say, can you give me that hydrogen? They will put a charge on it. And that charge is equivalent to the energy. So hydrogen is charged not as a molecule. If it were charged as a molecule, you know, it should be charged as a byproduct, which is essentially free, right? But it's not charged as a molecule, it's charged as an energy carrier. Rightfully so, but that is a fact that you have to keep in mind. Okay? And if you look at what is the right price of hydrogen, an energy equivalent price of hydrogen is about 120 to 150 rupees a kg, okay, at the user end. So keep this number in mind. Then you have to extract hydrogen from some source, right? If you do reforming, you have to supply heat for reforming. If you do electrolysis, you have to supply electricity. So you have to supply energy in some kind to release that hydrogen. So it is either accompanied with CO2 emissions, or you have to pay for the low efficiency of your device. An SMR has very high efficiencies, but an electrolyzer has not such great efficiency. So you have to pay a cost for that. Hydrogen has very, very low density, and that's the biggest problem of hydrogen, right? Its gravimetric energy density is huge, but its volumetric energy density is pathetic, right? That's the biggest problem with hydrogen. So if I take a very fancy composite cylinder, which stores hydrogen at 700 bar, and if I weigh that cylinder and weigh the hydrogen gas in that cylinder, it's only about 7 weight percent. Okay, there's nothing, right? It's because the density is so low. So even if I charge up to 700 bar, I'm not really carrying a lot of hydrogen. Right? And that's why, you know, storing hydrogen in steel cylinders is the most useless idea you can think of. Okay, you have to make the cylinders as light as possible. That's where carbon fiber composites are coming in a big way for hydrogen storage. Hydrogen has very wide explosion limits. Everybody, you know, if I say hydrogen, people will say, ooh, you know, it's explosive, it burns without a flame. So there's a lot of safety concerns, right, that you have to take care of. It has a negative Joule-Thomson coefficient of expansion, right? So if I expand hydrogen, it doesn't cool, it heats up. If I pressurize, right, it goes the other way around. So you have to have very sophisticated, cooling and heating systems that go with compression and decompression. Right. So it's not just pressurizing it; it's pressurizing and cooling it. That becomes important. So there's a cost associated with that. It's a very small molecule, extremely permeable through everything. Okay. It reacts with everything, highly reactive. So it causes embrittlement. It diffuses through plastic pipelines and so on. So these are problems of carrying hydrogen through pipelines. High infrastructure cost, right? If I want to set up a hydrogen refueling station, like a gas pump, but pumping hydrogen, not oil or petrol or diesel, the cost of setting up that hydrogen pump is humongous because essentially of the compression cost. By the way, the same happens with electricity, okay? You want to charge your electric vehicles, there's huge amount of infrastructure required for doing the same. Non-availability of cost-effective fuel cell technologies, especially in India, and that is our primary driver for what I'm going to talk about. And most important, you know, electricity is a state-controlled commodity, right? Electricity comes to your house not through a private company, but through a state-owned company, most likely, right? Hydrogen, on the other hand, is more of a private sector commodity, right? And that makes a big difference. Why? Because I can subsidize electricity like nobody's business. How much electricity cost do we pay today? Anybody knows? Students? 8 rupees a unit? 7, 8, 10, depending on whether you are a private or a public company. So anywhere between 8 to 17 or 18 rupees a unit of electricity, right? The real cost, if you account for all the transmission losses and all of that, will be way more than that, right? So why is electricity, you know, somebody paying 17 rupees and somebody paying 7 rupees? Doesn't make sense, no? Electricity is electricity. Why should somebody pay 7 rupees and somebody pay 17 rupees? That's what the state can do. If you do the same for hydrogen, you know, then you may get hydrogen at much lower cost. 120 to 150 rupees a cost. Today, hydrogen will cost you 450 rupees a kg. Right? But if it becomes a state-owned commodity, then you may be paying 120 rupees a kg of hydrogen. If the whole situation changes there, suddenly hydrogen economy starts making big sense. Right? So electricity versus hydrogen, right, is a very interesting debate at a policy level, because one is state-controlled, the other is not. Okay, so in this difficult situation where India doesn't really still believe in hydrogen, electricity is state-owned versus hydrogen is not, how do we kick in anything to do with hydrogen in this country? I have another 20 minutes? Okay, so how do you do anything to do with hydrogen in this? Yeah.
Sir, I read that one way of storing hydrogen is metal hydride.
Yeah.
So is it a better way than making it
blender? So hydride still can store a very small amount of hydrogen, and the release of hydrogen from hydride is still a problem. Right? It requires storage at much lower temperatures, and the release is a problem. And most importantly, the weight of hydrogen that can be stored is very small. So 7% that I talked about is the world record today. Okay. Hydrides are about 2 to 3%.
So, sir, I guess it's a commercially viable procedure to store hydrogen.
How? With 3% hydrogen, how is it commercially viable? It's not. You're storing much less hydrogen than, so therefore your cost will be more. Okay. So, in the situation that we have in the country today, if you want to kickstart a new technology, yeah, you want to try to displace, you have the ambition to displace an incumbent fossil fuel carbon dioxide emitting technology of today with a cleaner, greener technology like hydrogen, how do you do it in the Indian ecosystem? The best way is to find an example which is a low-hanging fruit and which is very, very relevant to the country. So don't copy what somebody else is doing. Look at an example which is very country specific, okay? And that's what I'm going to talk about now. So, you know, we have in India the fastest growing telecom market, right? You have all heard of Jio? Revolutionized telecom in the country. Does anybody dispute that? Right. So we have really the fastest growing telecom market. We were 127 in the world 5 years ago in terms of how much data per capita we use. Today, we are number one in the world. Number one. None of you can live without your mobile phones, right? Yes, okay. So that's how much important telecom is, right? So very simple, right? Telecom is the fastest growing market and everybody wants access to a mobile phone 24/7, okay? We have close to 650,000 towers that are feeding you data and your mobile phones, right? If you look at, this is a survey that we did, of those 650,000 towers, how many towers have grid supply for how much period of time, okay? So towers, more than 20 hours of grid supply, 10%. Towers with 16 to 20 hours of grid supply, 20%, and so on and so forth. there is a fraction of towers that does not receive grid supply for 8 to 12 hours a day, or you know, supplies even less than 8 hours a day. And there is a significant fraction of that, about 40% of towers, let's say 30% conservative, 30% of towers do not have reliable grid supply for more than 8 hours a day. Right? Now, if I can take the view that, you know, you guys don't get your mobile phones to use for, you get only 8 hours of mobile phone usage, not 24/7. How many of you will like it? Okay, no hands raised, right? All the faculty might like it, but the students won't, right? And so here is a very interesting situation where you have a large number of towers, 30% of this, which is, you know, not a small number, requiring a lot of backup power supply. Most of them today run because they have diesel generator sets. We consume about 2 billion liters of diesel per year just to run our telecom tower so that you and I can use our mobile phones. 5 million tons of CO2 is emitted by using these diesel generator sets. So your carbon footprint is here, okay? All of you are emitting carbon, right? There are a lot of pilferage issues with diesel, right? And therefore this TRAI, right? You've heard of TRAI, Telecom Regulatory Authority of India, is pushing for greener alternatives. Remove DG sets, replace it with something else. My own company has 200,000 towers, Jio has 200,000 towers. Of those, 30,000 towers run on diesel generator. Many of them use a combination of lithium-ion battery and diesel generator. Now, we are the only company in Asia to have validated at a commercial, you know, at a large scale, and commercial validation as well as technological validation of a polymer electrolyte membrane fuel cell based power backup system as an alternative to diesel. Okay, as an alternative to diesel. In fact, more than 100 towers of Jio in the country today, many of them in Gurgaon, Noida area, are running on PEM fuel cell based systems. Okay. The problem, however, is that most of these fuel cells that we are using today are imported, and therefore their capex is very large compared to the alternative incumbent technology. So here is a very quick back of the envelope calculation of the initial capex investment versus the backup power time. And these are various technology options. The black one is your diesel generator. Okay. This one is your lithium-ion battery. And these are today's fuel cells and these are tomorrow's fuel cells, next generation fuel cells. Right? So these are capex investments. Okay. And this is plotted as a function of backup power time. So you're looking at, you know, if I have 4 hours of backup time required, below 4 hours, the lithium-ion battery makes actual sense. And therefore, most of the urban towers of Jio today, if you go there, you will see, you don't see a diesel backup generator, you will see a small battery pack, because they require less than 4 hours of backup power. The moment you cross 6 or 8 hours, which I said is about 30% of towers, the lithium-ion battery cost really rises, okay? And in fact, what we have shown is this alternative of fuel cell actually now makes sense for those towers which are beyond at least 8 hours of backup power requirement. Okay? The same thing is done with what is called the total cost of ownership, which is nothing but the capex and opex put together. And again, you will see that compared to a diesel backup, the fuel cell with a methanol reformer actually has more or less the same total cost of ownership. Right? Now, this is possible only if you do not import fuel cells. It is possible if the fuel cells are manufactured in the country with indigenous technology. Now note that technologies like fuel cells, which are new technologies, are not easily available for licensing. Reliance as a company cannot go out and license a fuel cell technology. We can go out and buy out a fuel cell company, but that is not of interest to us. Okay? We just want a license to manufacture fuel cells, that is not available. So which means you have to generate that technology in-house, and that is not enough. You have to set up the entire manufacturing system in the country. Only then the capex will come down, okay, and start making economical sense. So very simple analysis shows that if 30% of these 650,000 towers are converted to fuel cells and somebody actually tries to capture this market, it's a market of $1 billion, $1.6 billion. So it's not a small market, right? So this is an application which we thought is a low hanging fruit. Everybody in this country wants mobile phones 24/7. We are emitting a lot of carbon from it. If we set up a fuel cell manufacturing ecosystem in the country, this is a low hanging fruit that we can capitalize on. So this is where the CSIR program started, and I'm going to sort of rush through this program. We started this in partnership with Reliance to create the hydrogen fuel cell platform technology with the goal of localizing the manufacturing in the country, therefore reducing the capex, and with the performance that is benchmarked at the local, at the global level. So three labs came together, NCL, SECRI and MPL, came together along with industry partners, and we had our roles very nicely defined. We went through several phases of this program, very generously funded by the government through a special purpose vehicle called Enmitly. We got a funding close to 45 crores over the period of 10 years, right? So some of the faculty were asking me, money, paisa ka hai, you know, this is one, I was telling you that this is one example where if you think big, if you go out of your labs, partner with other people, other departments, other institutes and industry, money is not a problem, money will come, okay? I'm not going to go through all the details of it, but what we've essentially done is we have sort of started from raw materials. We have developed the know-how for making every single component of a fuel cell. These are graphite bipolar plates, catalyst, carbon paper, porous carbon papers, and what are the heart of the fuel cell called the membrane electrode assemblies. Put them together into small cells, then gradually scaled up. This is a 1 kilowatt fuel cell running. This is a round robin testing of 1 kilowatt fuel cells at six different places to study their durability and so on. And at the same time, there was a lot of background fundamental research that was done in areas of materials and polymers and modeling and simulations. The focus was on telecom towers. These were our stacks. We created a very nice facility to test these stacks, okay, under conditions that are simulated for towers. Okay, so this is our test bed. This entire know-how was generated in Reliance, and the test bed was set up in Reliance. A lot of, you know, very nice engineering, very classical chemical engineering happened to that, and this is our fuel cell stack being tested. This is data. This is performing. You know, this is benchmarking the performance of our fuel cells with commercially available, globally available fuel cells, durability data, and so on and so forth. But very importantly, this is a list of vendors we created. So this was a program that ran not just in the labs, but our scientists went to small scale manufacturers across the country. We have vendors in Bhopal, Chennai, Mumbai, Delhi, Pune, you know, four or five places. These are small vendors who didn't know anything about fuel cells, right? We introduced them to this concept. We convinced them that there is actually a market for this. They could make some business out of it. And today we have this chain of vendors who can manufacture the components of fuel cells. As a result of all this effort, we claim that if you were to import every single component of the fuel cell and put it together, it will cost you some amount. And if you actually indigenize all of it, the cost of putting together a fuel cell stack will reduce by a factor of 3. The best 300% reduction in the cost. Now it's just not just the fuel cell. It's a fuel cell with the entire system around it. You need to have methanol reformers, you need to have DC-DC converters, you need to have pipings, tubings, control systems, safety, all of it, right? So it's very classical chemical engineering. What is this? This is a basic engineering package. Right? The P&I diagram with all the heat and mass balances in it, the entire system. So the stack is only here. This is the reformer, and this all the balance of plant that comes in with it. Okay, this is our first prototype that was created, and that is now under testing in two of the Geo towers. And this is our fuel cell stack, which is integrated in this prototype. This is our small compact methanol reformer. Along the way, we had several innovations. This is our in-molded graphite bipolar plates. The uniqueness of this is all these features that you see are molded directly into the in the machine. Okay. Earlier we used to make blank plates and then with the CNC machine you engrave the flow channels. Today we don't do that. The cost of doing this is very high. If I directly mold in these plates, I get a 600% reduction in cost of this component. So with every single of these components, we have to look at different ways of doing things while making sure that the properties of the material do not take a hit. These graphite plates were actually immersed in phosphoric acid at 160 degrees for a month, okay, to see whether they would degrade, and nothing happened to them. It's not the graphite that degrades, but there is a binder, it's the polymeric binder, that can degrade under these very harsh conditions. You know, 83% phosphoric acid at 160 degrees for 1 month, right? And the polymer survives those conditions, right? There's a lot of innovation that happens, that happened in this. And so this is the ecosystem that we have tried to create over the past 10 years. On the one hand, there are labs, you know, students who are engaged in doing fundamental research in materials, in manufacturing processes, stack engineering, balance of plant, reformer design, and so on. At the other hand, this science is taken to a proof of concept technology development, where you actually build a component, the sub-assemblies and the stack and the whole system. Third, you create vendors who can actually manufacture those components so that the technology doesn't remain in the lab, it actually goes out to manufacturers. And lastly, and most importantly, you know, companies like Reliance, okay, who identify the application, right, who tell us this is where you should go, this is the application we should target, because there's a need for it, there's money in it, there's enough business opportunity for it. They are also the people who can do system integration. You know, scientists are, I can tell you, very bad at it. The companies know actually how to pull in resources and do system integration, right? How to do field trials, market development, all of that is required. So these four pillars is what is really required in what I call the PEM fuel cell ecosystem. Right? And there's nothing in hydrogen either. Hydrogen is still another ecosystem that needs to be developed. Okay, so I'm going to, for lack of time, skip. There's a lot of fundamental chemical, very classical chemical engineering that we did. You know, in fact, you know, fuel cell has been around for what, 100 years? The first fuel cell was developed by Gravy back in 1928, something like that. Yeah. So it's been around for a long time, but there was no real, you know, classical chemical engineering model, right? Because if you look at a fuel cell, I'm sure you, you know, as students of energy, you know what a fuel cell is. It's classical coupling of convection, mass transfer, and reaction engineering. Okay, there's everything in it. All transport phenomena coupled along with the equilibrium Nernst equation. So you have all fundamental chemical engineering coupled in it. Okay, you have hydrogen coming in, diffusing through this porous layer. So there's diffusion here. Then you have this blue layer, which is the catalyst where the reaction happens. So all the reaction kinetics happens here, plus the transport inside that catalyst layer. Then you have the membrane through which the protons transport. On the other side, you have oxygen coming in, it diffuses through this porous carbon layer, it diffuses through this catalyst layer, reacts with the protons to form water, and so on and so forth. So you have this entire, you know, mass transfer, reaction kinetics, and convection happening in these fuel cells. This is the design equation of the fuel cell, the voltage versus current density. This is the Nernst equilibrium voltage, and as you draw the system away from equilibrium, the voltage of the cells drops down. How much it drops amounts to what is the heat dissipated, the efficiency of the fuel cell, and this is the useful power on the lower side of the fuel cell. So the idea is to increase, the move this curve up and up so that you increase the efficiency of the fuel cell. How do you do that? There are 26 parameters that you can change. 26 parameters you can change, right? Now imagine going to the lab and say, okay, I'll change one parameter at a time. Okay, it will take you ages to do it. The worst thing that you can do. You'll say, okay, I'll do the next phase, I'll do a design of experiment, right? Still, it will take you enormous amount of time, and time is money, right, to do this. So the best way would be, or possibly a possible good way of doing this, is to understand fundamentally how a fuel cell works, right? Are all these 26 parameters really important? Okay, can you lump them into fewer parameters? And that is what we have tried to do. In fact, what we have tried to do in the last few years is to derive the most elegant, in my opinion, equation for the design curve of the fuel cell. This is the convection for flow of oxygen through the channels. This is the reaction term, and coupled with a lot of mass transport term. You can look, you know, chemical engineers will identify Kille modulus and so on, right? Very classical chemical engineering, and this is the design equation. Now, it turned out that we could solve all the coupled convection, transport and reaction kinetics in the fuel cell analytically, pen and paper, right, and be able to derive an analytical equation. And what is beautiful about these equations is that the 26 parameters that I talked about actually get lumped into seven lumped parameters, right? So it's much easier to deal with 7 parameters than 26 parameters. And it's naturally happened. You're not done anything artificially. In the process of deriving these equations, you get these very nice lumped 7 parameters, which you can then change. All of them, of course, have physical meaning. They're all dimensionless variables that have physical meanings. They're basically 6 current density scales and 1 ohmic resistance. And to prove the worth of this model, here is a comparison between our analytical expression, a full 3D simulation run with a very costly COMSOL simulator, and experimental data. And it's not doing a bad job at all, right? And you can predict then all the profiles of oxygen and current density and potential inside the fuel cell, in various components of the fuel cell, and so on and so forth. And what we've come up with at the end of it is, instead of a very expensive COMSOL simulator, right, which, you know, like you, I also complain, I don't have money to buy a COMSOL license for a COMSOL simulator. Okay, then I realize that, why do I need that money? I just need to apply my mind, right? And what we've done then is simply created an Excel macro, right? And all my parameters are here, and I can change them at will, and on real time it will change, it will show you how the polarization, the design equation or the design curve changes, which parameters are important, which region of the curve they affect, and so on and so forth. There's a lot of physical insights that you get out of this. Okay, so there are, you know, having done this, we are now looking at various other applications. We are looking at applications in greening our retail business. We are looking at converting some of our forklifts, which are diesel operated, into battery or fuel cell operated forklifts. We are looking at possible ways of greening our transportation sector. In fact, people, you know, should, who have time, should do this kind of analysis. 61% of our CO2 emissions from transport comes from heavy vehicles, trucks, right? If I look at a truck, the cost of battery unit required to run a truck, okay, the trucks that we see on our road, is about 22 lakhs, just the battery unit, not the truck itself, just the battery unit, okay? If I were to have a fuel cell truck, okay, it will cost me about 14 lakhs, much lower than that amount. So if you ever want to go beyond fossil fuel based trucks, right, don't go with battery, terrible option, go with fuel cell. So in general, heavy vehicles, long range transport, don't go for batteries, go with fuel cell, that's a far better option. The OPEX is of course higher than the battery, and that's because the electricity is subsidized, right, state versus private, that's what I talked about. The electricity is subsidized, so the battery OPEX is lower. Fuel cell hydrogen is not state subject, expensive, OPEX is higher, but the CAPEX is much, much lower. So the total cost of ownership for the fuel cell is still better for trucks. There's somebody waiting for this to be pushed, right? You can do the same for passenger cars. And we believe that don't just use lithium-ion battery-based cars, actually use a hybrid car, which is called a plug-in fuel cell hybrid. It has a battery and a fuel cell working in tandem. The battery takes all the transients because the discharge is so fast, right? The fuel cell takes the stable load. So if you design a car where the battery and fuel cell work in tandem, again a very classic chemical engineering problem, somebody should put their mind to it, right? We actually believe that this is a far better option than simply a BEV or a battery electric vehicle. Okay, residential fuel cells. It's there are about 50,000 such fuel cells already running in Japan and Europe. Okay, this we don't think is really a low hanging fruit, but eventually it might come. All right, I'm going to skip some of it and say that you know the ultimately the big picture of hydrogen ecosystem is this: you have various ways of generating hydrogen in centralized or distributed way, and you have various applications that are waiting to be replaced with. Where the incumbent technology will be replaced with hydrogen. And in every case, there is some number that we believe is an estimated market size for a company to get in there and get into this business. It may or may not be Reliance, but hopefully some company will come in and do that. Okay, so with that, I would like to thank you.
Thank you.
I'm sure all of you can thank him once again with a very massive appreciation. Thank you, Ashish. Can we have a few questions? It's getting to be lunchtime, but let's say two or three questions, quick questions. You have mics.
Sir, you talked about extracting the hydrogen from ammonia. Like, so if we talk about the purification of biogas, like, so the purification of biogas, the byproducts we get like the ammonia and CO2, like, and H2S. So, so it's kind of packaged up, so we can use CO2 in the extraction of the fuel, and we can extract hydrogen from the ammonia. And also from the hydrogen from the H2S as a byproduct we get from the purification of biogas. So, is it a feasible option to get into the hydrogen economy?
Yeah. So not so much biogas to ammonia or hydrogen sulfide. That's not the way. Biogas is essentially methane, right? So you can extract hydrogen from methane. Ammonia and H2S are only small impurities in methane, which actually needs to be removed. But hydrogen from methane coming from biogas is a great option. And in fact, there is a company in Pune called AgroGas. You can go and visit their website, which is trying to do exactly the same. So they are taking biomass, doing an anaerobic fermentation to make biogas out of it, cleaning it, and then reforming it to make hydrogen. Or, you know, sell it as biogas itself. It's an automotive grade biogas.
If we clean the biogas, like the raw biogas, in the cleaning process, we are getting ammonia, like. So.
But that is a very tiny quantity. The hydrogen that will come out is very small. So what Australia is doing is they are doing Haber Bosch to make ammonia, but the hydrogen there comes not from reforming, but from water electrolysis. And electricity for electrolysis comes from solar and wind. See, Australia has humongous land and, you know, abundance of solar flux, you know. So therefore, they are using all of that to convert solar into hydrogen. And that hydrogen goes into Haber Bosch to make ammonia. Ammonia is compressed, liquefied, and actually transported across the ocean to Japan, where they are doing the reverse. They're cracking ammonia, right, and to get hydrogen back. So this today is actually happening. I'm not talking, it's not a fairy tale, but it's today happening. There's a pact between Australia and Japan to actually make this happen. Interestingly, Brunei is the other country that is doing it, in Japan. And Japan has made an offer to the Indian government to do the same. Whether we take it up or not, we'll see.
Thank you, sir.
Can we have one more quick question, please?
Sir, technology has for betterment of human being, but over a period of time we see that all the technologies or most of the technologies have some offshoot. Like we developed the plastics, so now you are telling that plastics are doing what to the human beings. Similarly, drugs are developed, but what they are doing, body resistance. Similarly, like fossil fuels, so huge technologies, but now we are facing the problem of carbon dioxide. So although hydrogen technology is not fully developed till now, but what are the possible offshoot of it? I mean, when we have the hydrogen technology fully developed and we say that with it, this kind of things are happening. So what are those?
Very, very important and philosophical question. I must compliment you for that. So, you know, I think you have to go back to the Eastern philosophy, which is our philosophy, right? And ask the question which Gandhiji also asked, right? Need versus greed is the question. How much is enough, right? And many of the technologies today are feeding the greed and not the need. That's the problem, right? And that's where the offshoots, as you talked about, come from. So sustainability is essentially that, right? How do you make sure that you don't leave a major negative footprint because of what you do? And in that sense, in that context, we believe hydrogen makes sense. Question is there somebody willing to pay the cost of it? Right? Ultimately, it comes down to economics, whether you like it or not. Right? So, hydrogen, you can take, you know, like I said, take biomass, very sustainable, convert that to hydrogen and use it. The cost of that hydrogen is the question. Who is willing to pay for that cost? Why? Because today you are used to subsidized diesel. Why is diesel 65 rupees a liter? Does anybody agree that diesel should be 65 rupees a liter? Most of you will say probably less, right? But the real price of diesel is way more than that. Way more than that, right? So, you know, we are used to subsidies. Subsidies are used to feed the greed. That's the problem, right? So, if you do all the costing right, which is to say that all your carbon footprints get charged, you get taxed for the carbon footprint, then the real economics will start making sense. Then your offshoots will automatically come down, right? I think that's where the problem lies.
Sir, there is new concept coming, hythane. Hydrogen and methane is mixed as a fuel. So what is this exactly new technology, and what are the advantage in the today's scenario for hythane?
Yeah, so hythane, you know, because the energy density of hydrogen is much higher, at least three times higher than methane, right? Two and a half times higher than methane. Therefore, even 5% substitution of methane with hydrogen, your calorific value goes up by that much, right? And so your emissions go down, because when hydrogen burns, you only get water out. So you are reducing emissions and you are increasing the calorific value of the fuel. So that's the advantage of hythane, right? But transporting hythane, and how much somebody is, I think one of your faculty is working on hydrogen transportation through methane in pipelines, right? There is a restriction on how much hydrogen you can dose into methane, because of various issues that I talked about: permeability of hydrogen, entanglement of hydrogen, and then so safety of hydrogen. So many issues are there. So, but there is, the advantages are in terms of reduced emissions and higher calorific value.
So, do you see how much?
Yeah. So, depending on the infrastructure that already exists in different countries, you can dose to different levels. So the European network is actually capable of taking full hydrogen. So they already have a gas grid, and they are saying that eventually we can convert that entire gas grid, which is today methane, natural gas, to hydrogen.
Good afternoon, sir. Yeah. On behalf of our entire batch, we thank you for giving us such an intriguing lecture. So my question is that, when you talked about using hydrogen fuel cells in vehicles instead of lithium-ion batteries, my concern is that when we have to consider the safety point of view of the hydrogen fuel cells to be used in the equipment, when we use other safety-related equipment, like to prevent the hydrogen leakage or explosion or something, won't it become more expensive than lithium-ion batteries?
Yeah, no, good question. There are two. My answer can be split in two parts, right? Was it 2 days ago in the news that a lithium battery exploded in somebody's pocket?
Yes.
Okay. So who says lithium-ion battery is also very safe? Okay. Now, there are technologies coming in for lithium-ion batteries which replace liquid electrolytes with solid electrolytes. Okay, and that will be safer, far more safer than the conventional lithium-ion battery. But today's lithium-ion batteries that are used by Elon Musk in Teslas are not solid-state lithium-ion batteries. Okay, so Tesla cars have burnt, and there are videos on it on YouTube. You can see that. Okay, so don't go with the concept that lithium-ion batteries are also very safe. They are not. Okay, the liquid electrolytes in lithium-ion batteries are extremely explosive. Number two, the fuel cell. It's not so much the fuel cell, but the hydrogen tank, which is pressurized at 700 bar, on which you are sitting as a driver. Right? So you're sitting on a bomb, right? You should be more worried about that than the fuel cell. Right? Now, you can also watch the Toyota Mirai crash test videos on YouTube. They're available on YouTube. Okay? And the whole car is designed for the most, what is that called? There's a word for it, the crash level. And at what momentum you go and hit a solid wall. Those crash tests have been done and it has passed all those tests. So the engineering has been done in that way that it is safe. Right? The cylinders themselves are rated to 1200 bars. They're used at 700 bars. And they are all carbon fiber epoxy composites. Okay? It's a polyethylene bottle taped with carbon fiber composites. And they have undergone all the tests. So yes, they are unsafe, both technologies. But do you think petrol cars or CNGs were unsafe? Are safe? I don't think so. When CNG, and you were too young for it, when I was like your age and CNG came in India for a big way, same questions were asked. Should I have a compressed high pressure CNG cylinder in my car? Today, everybody is used to it. You don't even question it. Your acceptance level of the technology has gone up because the technology is very mature. The same thing will happen with hydrogen.
Thank you. Thank you, Ashish. I think we have to stop. Thank you.
Dr. Lele, for this delightful and enlightening talk. We are privileged to hear you, sir. I'm sure all of us learned a lot from this opportunity. I hope everyone here will make efforts for alternate fuel, that is hydrogen, at suitable time instead of waiting for China to go miles ahead of us, like you mentioned, sir. Now I invite Professor P. Vijay and Mili Mehra to present a memento to our distinguished speaker, Dr. Ashish Lele. Thank you, sir, and thank you, Mili. I now invite Mr. Amit Kumar Thakur, Faculty Coordinator of ISCHE UPA Student Chapter, to give a vote of thanks.
Thank you, Saman. As a Faculty Coordinator of UPS ISCHE Student Chapter, I would like to say on behalf of all my colleagues that we all feel very lucky today that we attended this motivating and informative lecture on hydrogen ecosystem opportunities and challenges. In this lecture, Dr. Lele elaborated the importance of hydrogen in Indian economy. Dr. Lele also narrated several technological and scientific challenges that needs to be addressed for pushing hydrogen agenda. I believe that this talk will certainly motivate the young minds present here. I formally thank Dr. Lele for kindly accepting our invitation and giving us this excellent talk. I also wish to thank our Chancellor, Dr. S.J. Chopra, our Vice Chancellor, Dr. Deependra Kumar Jha, and our Dean, School of Engineering, Professor Suresh Kumar, for their blessings and support for this program. Well, an event like this cannot happen overnight. The wheel started rolling months ago. All thanks to Professor Santosh Gupta, who literally ran between the departments from Monday to Saturday for last minute uncertainties. I wish to thank our admin department and our finance department for their hard work. Finally, I wish to thank you, the audience, for your patient listening. Thank you.